Good morning. Welcome to Bethel Baptist Church this morning. Let's stand and let's sing that song, "There's Not a Friend Like the Lowly Jesus." If you notice, my voice is a bit hoarse this morning, so I need all of your help singing with me as best you can. "There's Not a Friend Like a Lowly Jesus." There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. None else could heal all our souls' diseases. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one.
Good morning, church. What a joy it is to see you all here this morning, and to, as we just sung about, there's not a friend like Jesus, you know, and we're so glad that we're able to come together, celebrate his love for us, as well as our friendship in which we have, not just with one another, but with God through his son, Jesus Christ. And so as we've come together today to worship him, to our guest, we say welcome, and we're delighted that you are here. And if you're on Facebook watching us, we say welcome. We do ask if you would take a moment and comment and let us know that you're watching with us, and maybe even let us know where you're watching from. And as we get ready to continue our service today, let's put our minds and our thoughts on the Word of God today. Psalms 140 is something that really is pertinent to our day and time and all of which we are facing right now. So if you would, read with me aloud. O Lord, rescue me from evil people. Protect me from those who are violent, those who plot evil in their hearts and stir up trouble all day long. Their tongues sting like a snake. The venom of a viper I'll read it. Their tongues sting like a snake. The venom of a viper drips from their lips. You know, there's been an old saying that used to go around and say, sticks and stones will break my bones, but words will never hurt me. You do realize that's a lie, right? How many of us have been hurt by words? Every single one of us. Now let me throw out something to you. How many times have you hurt somebody with your words? Oh boy, you know. Now all of a sudden we go from being the victim to being the one that inflict the pain. And so as we think about this morning, let us make sure that our words are not like that of the evil one. And know that in this day and time, we depend upon the protection of God with all the evil that is going on. And so let's remain standing for prayer this morning. And with Michael Lining, y'all hear him sing. I've asked him if he would pray, so y'all would know that he is spiritual. Michael, pray for us, buddy.
Father, thank you so much for this beautiful day that we have to worship you in your house. Thank you for all that you've done in our lives this week, also in our country this week. I pray that you would please use us as people of Bethel Baptist Church to be a light to our community and to be a blessing to one another, to edify each other in faith today. And I pray that our worship would be sweet before you, and I pray that you would please bless us in everything that we do, that we would learn and we would grow, and as we go from this place today, we would leave changed. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's sing this morning, "Because He Lives, Amen."
I believe in the Son. Let my soul join the world. dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the stone.
To look on him.
Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God.
But with himself.
You know, there are sometimes events that happen in our nation that you may find it so significant that in your mind you marked where you were, what you were doing whenever the word came to you. I know where I was Friday. I know what I was doing Friday whenever I heard the word come over the radio that the Roe versus Wade had been overturned by our Supreme Court. And I tell you, you know, it was an emotional moment for me. It truly was. You know, I was doing what I do. I was in my garage, in my driveway, working on a lawnmower, and I had my radio playing, and they came across about this. And I just had to just stop. And I know that my neighbors just thought I was working on a lawnmower, but I knelt down next to my lift table and just used it as my altar. And just praising God for the news that I just received. Now, folks, I want you to understand this. It is a huge, monumental victory for life. And it's not turning our government into a theocracy. It's just doing what is right, morally, ethically, and lawfully, even by the Constitution. Now, We take that one step further. This is not a time for the church to gloat. So don't. So what do? We respond to God in thanksgiving and saying, thank you, God, for the lives that will be saved. But in the same breath, we also say, now, God, use us, use me, to help make a difference. And I want to stand before you once again, and we've done this a couple of times before. And that is that Bethel Baptist Church is a church that is pro-family. And that is that if you choose to adopt or to foster a child, this church will help you in any and every way we can. We make that vow to you. And we've already begun to do that with some that have already begun the process. And we're going to continue to do it. Now, this is also a time for us to realize that because abortion is not going to be so prevalent and so immediately available right here, even in Greenville, South Carolina, that means that we might have to come alongside of ladies and families that maybe has a unexpected pregnancy and help love them and nurture them, provide for them, and care for them. And so, folks, the what seems to be the battle may have already been won as far as for states' rights, but the work is really just really beginning. For us, because we want to be there. We want to minister. We want to love on these families, and in particular on these ladies and these little children. And so let me encourage you that if you're here, if you're watching on Facebook, if you know of anyone that is going through an unplanned pregnancy or has become, you know, they may have already planned to have an abortion, and now all of a sudden it's not going to be immediately available to them. Will you let them know that we as a church are not here to condemn them, but we're here to help them? And we'll do anything and everything we can. And there's also a network of churches called the Three Rivers Baptist Association, which we are a member of, that I know that there's other pastors who feel the same way that I do. That if it becomes overwhelming for us and our little church, I know other churches in which I can call. And so let's not spend 1 second of gloating. Let's spend our time being thankful and getting ready for the work. And where does that begin? In prayer. In prayer and thanking God, and in prayer saying, God, here am I, use me. And praying for how this is going to make a difference. So let's spend a moment in prayer today and praying for what is going on in our nation right now. Father God, we want to thank you, Lord, that after 50 years of darkness in our nation, God, that you have allowed the Supreme Court to have their hearts and their lives touched by what is true, what is right, what is honorable, life. God, we know, Father, that there's ones that would want to cause suffering and pain to those of us who are pro-life. God, I know this morning, even as I read on the news about a church who posted something on their church sign about the decision and how that church sign was vandalized last night, I pray, God, that we would see, Lord, the results of this decision come forth in positive ways. But help us, Father, as your children, as your church, Lord, to stand on the truth. Father, to help direct people, Lord, into the way, the truth, and the life. And that, God, that we might be able to teach your truth, Lord, of proper relationships. And, Father, to support ones, Father, in times of pregnancy, delivery, and either letting that child go into adoption or even fostering, or helping them to be able to raise that child or those children. God, help us, Lord, to support those who are choosing to foster or to adopt. God, help them to be able to know that we're here. And then, God, we come to you and ask, God, please provide us with the people and the resources and the funds, God, to be able to do everything that we can to be able to support families. We thank you, Father, for what you're doing. And Father, in a day and time when our nation seems to be going 100 miles an hour backwards, I thank you, Lord, for giving us this little glimmer of light and of hope. And Father, may this change come forth, Lord, in mighty ways. Lord, for your glory. Lord, for your victory. And Lord, forgive us where we have failed you. And Lord, may we desire, Father, to live for you. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Before we sing again, some of you are beginning to use your multi-purpose tool that's called a bulletin. It's also known as a church fan. The air conditioner was set this morning. It started cooling off, and it has quit. So I'm just letting you know we're sorry. We don't know what's happened. And so if you need to go get yourself a bulletin to fan, And we'll go from there. And there's also water in the welcome center in the refrigerator if you need some. Now we can sing.
All right, let's sing. Thou art worthy, thou art worthy, O Lord. You may remain seated as we sing. That will be. Would you stand as we sing?
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, Caleb. All righty. The kids go out. Which, by the way, it's cool upstairs.
Yeah.
Hey, let me encourage you to take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Daniel as we're preaching through the book of Daniel at this particular time, and been able to get at least one chapter in each week. And we come to another one of those famous stories in the Bible, and that is Daniel in the lion's den. You know, but a lot of people know that story, but only as Daniel was thrown into a lion's den. But they don't understand the surroundings of what took place, why it happened, and those kinds of things. So while you're turning in your Bible, Daniel chapter 6, let me give you a real quick Reader's Digest Roadrunner update as to what's been going on, okay? Daniel is in Jerusalem. He's a teenager. And the Babylonians overtake the Israelites only because God allowed it because of their sinfulness. God was going to use this captivity for his glory. And so King Nebuchadnezzar sends a message that he wants all of the brightest, smartest, best-looking young men to be taken from Israel back from Jerusalem into Babylon, and that they would then serve him and his royal court. Well, we know that four of those was Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. All right, now they were teenagers, and we know that they refused the king's delicacies. They also, even though they had to attend the king's school, they maintained their faith, their allegiance, and their worship to God. And they continued to grow even in their faith, even whenever they had to be surrounded in the enemy camp. Well, the king had a dream, and he called in all of his wise people, and they could not tell him what the dream was, nor what it meant. So then King Nebuchadnezzar says, well, just kill all the wise men, I'll start all over. Well, Daniel was going to be, and his friends were going to be some of those that were going to be put to death. But Daniel begs off and says, hey, give us a little bit of time. So Daniel and his friends then begin to pray, and God revealed to Daniel what the dream was and what it meant. So he goes to King Nebuchadnezzar, he tells him what it meant, and as a result of this, Daniel is highly elevated in the nation. Well, King Nebuchadnezzar, while he was very impressed with Daniel's God, and he even praised that God, he still was not a true convert. And so he then builds a huge statue of himself. And Nebuchadnezzar puts out an order that at a certain time, with all the musical instruments playing, that everybody is supposed to bow down to him. Well, three of them, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, did not bow down. As a result of this, they were arrested, and they were tried, and then they were thrown into where? The fiery furnace. I'm just making sure y'all are paying attention here, you know, because some of y'all are beginning to look at me like a glazed donut. You know, you done a Krispy Kreme donut. You done glazed over. Stay with the history on this, okay? You got to know it, okay? Well, whenever King Nebuchadnezzar looks into the fiery furnace, he does not see three, but he sees four. And we know that that fourth one was a Christophany. That was Jesus with the Hebrew children. And Nebuchadnezzar was so impressed by this that it led him to having a faith in God. Because the soldiers that delivered the three Hebrew children into the fiery furnace, they were consumed by the fire. They died. But yet the Hebrew children came out not even smelling like smoke, and not a hair on their head or their body was even singed. Now, it then goes silent for a while, and now we see later on that now Daniel is from a teenager to where now he's in his early 80s, about 82 years old. And this whole time, Daniel has continued to be faithful to God. And the time now comes that Nebuchadnezzar has died. His grandson is actually the king now, Belshazzar. Now, Belshazzar is Daniel's slave name. Just remember, Belt, that's Daniel, okay? Bel, because somebody don't wrong his bell, was the king, all right? So the king then has a party, and he invites everybody to come to the party. And he's even using those things that are meant for God, part of the relics that his grandfather had taken from the temple in Jerusalem when they originally besieged Israel in Jerusalem, and they brought it back in. So they're drinking their wine out of the holy cups. And a hand mysteriously appears and begins to write on the wall, and it scared the living daylights out of him, out of the king. Well, the king then wants to know what these words mean. And nobody could tell him. The king's grandmother hears about it, comes to the rescue, and tells her grandson, go find Daniel. He can tell you. So then Daniel comes, and he looks at the words, and he's able to interpret them. And whenever he does, he explains to them, your kingdom is at an end, and so is your life. Well, the king was so impressed that Daniel had interpreted, he elevated Daniel again even higher into the kingdom. And that very night, he was killed, the king was killed, and the Medes and the Persians overtook the Babylonian nation. Now, I just gave you a lot of history in just a few minutes. And yes, there will be a test on this later on, so I hope you were taking notes. So, are you with me so far? Okay. So now we come into Daniel chapter 6, and this is where the story picks up. Darius the Mede decided to divide the kingdom into 120 provinces, and he appointed a high officer to rule over each province. The king also chose Daniel and two others as administrators to supervise the high officers and protect the king's interest. Daniel soon proved himself more capable than all the other administrators and high officers because of Daniel's great ability. The king made plans to place him over the entire empire. Now let's stop right here with the history lesson, okay? Let's go back and let's look at what has happened here. Here is a Hebrew, a Jewish man. He's probably around 88 years old now, and he has served the previous kings, the Babylonian kings, but now the Persian and the Medes had taken over the kingdom, and the king had noticed that, you know, King Belshazzar may have not been a real good king, but one thing that he could do was he knew how to pick good people to be in leadership positions. He knew how to surround himself with talent. And so Belshazzar's talent that he has surrounded himself by is now serving the new king. So there was not the new king came in and cleared the administration off and started all over again. He kind of did something that I admire in him, and that is that before you go into a place as a leader, you don't just clean house with those and then hire in who you want. You come in to look, you observe, you notice, you find out where their skills are and where their talents and their abilities, because you might be able to use that person. That's management 101, leadership 101, okay? So, the king has now got Daniel there, and it's been about 6 years, and he's noticed that boy's good. That grown man, that old man, he's good at what he's doing. And so this enemy king sees that Daniel has some very great ability. And the king made plans to place him over the entire empire. Now you got to remember, Daniel is not a Persian. He's not a Mede. He's not a Babylonian. He is Hebrew. He is Jewish. Yet the king sees that there's something about him that his abilities are just the cream of the crop. And so he looks at it and says, I'm going to put Daniel in charge of all of this. Now, do you realize that whenever you get a promotion, there's somebody that did not get promoted who felt like they should have been promoted? How many of y'all ever been in that kind of situation? Shake your head at me. Yeah. How many of you all ever been in the situation where you saw somebody get promoted that you was wondering why I didn't get promoted? If he or she got promoted, my stars, why was I overlooked? Because you feel like you're a whole lot better. You could have done a better job. You've been there longer. You know, you've been more faithful. You know, you've done everything that needed to be done, and then all of a sudden they promote somebody else. Boy, ain't that a letdown. It's disappointing, is it not? But understand that whenever it's you that gets promoted, you're going to have some enemies. And whenever you don't get promoted, be careful that you don't become the enemy to the one who was promoted. But Daniel's promotion created enemies of him. They were somewhat his counterparts. They were his equals until Daniel was promoted to over the entire empire. So let's see how the enemy reacted to all of this. It says, then the other administrators and high officers began searching for some fault in the way Daniel was handling government affairs, but they couldn't find anything to criticize or condemn. He was faithful, always responsible, and completely trustworthy. Now let's just stop right here just for a moment. This whole series of sermons is called Dare to be Daniel. And whenever we dare to be Daniel, let's make sure that we're looking at these attributes like he was above reproach. They couldn't find anything to criticize him or condemn him for. Wow. That's impressive. So then they knew that he was faithful. He was always responsible and completely trustworthy. Could that be said about you and me? If there's goals in life to try to maybe reach towards, it may not be to get the highest promotion that you can and to climb that corporate ladder as high as you can, but instead it may be just to be known that you were faithful, always responsible, and completely trustworthy. That's some life goals to go after. And he says, so they concluded, our only chance of finding ground for accusing Daniel will be in connection with, are you ready for this? The rules of his religion. You see the world coming after Christians like you've never seen them before. I told you last week, we're no longer on the home team, folks. The world is not cheering for us. And it wasn't just now, you even see it happening to Daniel. And then it says, so the administrators and high officers went to the king and said, long live King Darius. We are all in agreement. We administrators, officials, high officers, advisors, and governors, that the king should make a law that would be strictly enforced. Now, let me explain something to you about this right here. You've heard the statement before, united we stand, divided we... Exactly. Even whenever the enemy unites, they can have victory. And let me show you some of the ploys in which they imply, you know, some of the ploys in which they institute it right here. Look at this and tell me this is not something that we even see today. First off, not one went, but we went. I don't know who the spokesman was, but it's not just I, it's now we. Number, powers in numbers. And it says, we are all in agreement. They probably had their meetings, their secret meetings. They probably had a petition that was passed around, get rid of Daniel petition. Okay? And then it says, and then identifies who we are, shows their importance. The administrators, the officials, the high officers, the advisors, and governors. In other words, you know, we are important people to you, King. And then says, the king should make a law that will be strictly enforced. Do you not see a lot of this in politics even today? Now, give orders that for the next 30 days, any person who prays to anyone, divine or human, except to you, your majesty, will be thrown into the den of lions. And now, your majesty, issue and sign this law so it cannot be changed, an official law of the Medes and the Persians that cannot be revoked. So King Darius signed the law. Now, let me stop right here, because I see so many parallels to what is happening even today in our nation. And that is that they're jealous of Daniel. They're fearful of Daniel. They only want to tear Daniel down, even to the point to where they think they've got the perfect trap that will either break his will where he will have to bow down and pray only to the king, Darius, or get him killed by thrown into the lion's den. Y'all with me on this? So they go to him, they flex their importance to the king, and then they, I'll use the term, bootlick him and saying, except to you, your majesty. For those of you in the military, you know what I'm talking about. We'll be thrown into the den of lions. They probably said, and be thrown into the den of lions. Didn't make it real clear, probably. And now, your majesty, issue and sign this law so that it cannot be changed. An official of the law, Medes and Persians, cannot be revoked. Here, sign it. And he just signs it. And he doesn't even know what he was signing, probably. Yeah, I ain't going there. But I'm just saying to where... So he signs it off. But when Daniel learned that the law had been signed, catch this, he went home and knelt down. These two next words are so important. As usual, don't skip that part, in his upstairs room with its windows open towards Jerusalem, he prayed three times a day, just as he had always done. Don't miss that part either. As usual, and it's as he had always done, giving thanks to his God. Then the officials went together to Daniel's house and found him praying and asking for God's help. Listen to me right here, okay? Let's just take this one bite at a time. When Daniel heard about the law, no doubt those who got the king to sign the law probably was not so much concerned about anybody else. It was, they had their bullseyes painted on Daniel. He was their target, not because of anything that he had done wrong, but because of his faith and allegiance to God. There's plenty of times where we're going to be the enemy just because of our faith in God. And then from there, we see where they, you know, Daniel did what he usually did. This did not drive Daniel to go start praying. Daniel just did what he already did. That was, he already was praying. And he did not stop anything that he was doing before. Let me assure you of this. There are constant lawsuits brought into the judicial system against churches to get us to stop doing what we do. And right now, one of the last ones is a church in Texas that the judge has ruled that the church has to turn over all of its financial records to a civil organization to examine it. Okay, you know, since we're here at Bethel Baptist Church and we have an open policy with our books, we give you financial reports. We don't hide money. You want to know something? Come ask me or Claudia, especially Claudia. She knows a whole lot more than what I do about the books because I don't keep up with it. I just stay out of her way. Amen, Claudia? Best I can. And so we also have a treasurer, Randy Watkins. And we also have a stewardship team. And so we're not operating in the dark and secretively, but yet because of something that happened, a man was able to actually sue the church, and the church has got to turn over all of its financial records. You see, this is where any other time, if it was the other way around, they would be screaming, separation of church and state, separation of church and state. But when the state does it to the church, it's okay. So there's a whole lot more to that backstory. But I'm just telling you to where they're constantly doing this. If you look back to where whenever Madeline Murray O'Hare was able to be successful in getting prayer and Bibles banned from schools. But let me tell you something that you don't realize about that. The law that she was able to get invoked in public schools does not and should not ever prevent a student from bringing a Bible to school or bowing their head in prayer and being able to pray or to be able to read their Bibles. So if you have children that go to public school, you can unashamedly, lawfully, tell your child to take a Bible to school if they want to take one. And also, don't be ashamed to bow their head and to pray like whenever they get ready to eat. You don't have to tell a kid to pray before they take a test. There's always going to be prayer in school as long as what there's tests in schools, right? Okay, y'all need to wake up here now. Okay, stay with me. Stay with me. I know it's warm, but stay with me. All right. But they imposed just enough of it that they struck enough fear in people that they bowed down and cowered. Oh, we can't have Bibles in school. Oh, we can't pray in school no more or anything. So much so that a teacher, forgive me for not remembering which state it's in, a teacher, she would bow her head and pray at lunchtime, and she's lost her job over it. She's suing the school board because she bowed her head and would pray during her mealtime with the students at the table. There's a coach in Maine that at the end of the game would go to the 50-yard line and kneel down and pray. He did not ask other students to come and join him. It was just his belief. He would go and kneel, and other students just came out there with him. He was fired. That's going all the way to the Supreme Court. The sad thing is that if a Muslim teacher wants to break out a prayer rug during the middle of class and face it towards Mecca and bow down, you better not say nothing to them. That's discrimination. It's only against Christians. Have you noticed that? And so they went right to Daniel's house because they knew, just wait, because we know at this particular time is one of his prayer times. Just wait. Bam, Daniel shows up in the window, kneeling down praying to God, and they're like, we got him. This is going to be the end of him. This is so good. And they noticed that Daniel was, and the scripture records for us, they went together to Daniel's house and found him praying, remember now, usual, and as he always done, and asking for God's help. He wasn't asking for a bigger house, a faster car, a nice new truck, a new bass boat, campers with more slide outs, fat bank accounts, more jewelry, all the stuff that prosperity preachers would tell you that he might have been praying for. Remember I told you how I feel about them? But instead, he was asking God for help. It wasn't the first time. It was what he was already usually doing and what he had always done. God, help me. Remember last week, we looked about what he prayed for. And one of those was wisdom and for insight and for guidance. And then it goes on, verse 12 says, so they went straight to the king and tattled on Daniel. One way to read that. Reminding him about his law. A king, did you not sign a law that for the next 30 days, any person who prays to anyone, divine or human, except to you, your majesty, will be thrown into the den of lions? I mean, this is so middle school, but do you see it? Yes, the king replied, that decision stands. It is an official law of the Medes and the Persians that cannot be revoked. Then they told the king, and I can only imagine the smirk on their face, that man Daniel, one of the captives from Judah, is ignoring you and your law. He still prays to his God 3 times a day. Hearing this, king was deeply troubled, and he tried to think of a way to save Daniel. He spent the rest of the day looking for a way to get Daniel out of this predicament. He realized, I done messed up, because Daniel is the cream of the crop. He's the best I got, but the law is the law. And he says, in the evening, the men went together to the king and said, your majesty, You know that according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, no law that the king signs can be changed. Now, understand this right here. They went to him earlier in the day, reminded him about the law, told on Daniel. The king has taken a reprieve. He's trying to figure out a way to get Daniel out of it. They're getting it, the enemy's getting impatient. And so they go back to him that evening and it's like, hey, are you going to do this or not? So at last the king gave orders for Daniel to be arrested and thrown into the den of lions. The king said to Daniel, may your God, whom you serve so faithfully, rescue you. And a stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den. The king sealed the stone with his own royal seal, and the seal of his nobles, so that no one could rescue Daniel. Then the king returned to his palace and spent the night fasting. He refused his usual entertainment and couldn't sleep at all that night. Now, understand this right here. When the king said, yeah, it's the law, do what you gotta do. We see this somewhat even as what, you know, the governor did with Jesus. You know, I washed my hands of this, but he was still guilty. And he said, you know, take him away. And so Daniel is now faced with going into the lion's den. And this is where I want to be more like Daniel, because I'll be honest with you all, y'all know me well enough to know that you want to fight, bring on a fight. If I would have been in that situation, my personality at this time, without trying to grow in the Lord, would very easily be, I would fight you like I was the third monkey trying to get on the ark and it's beginning to rain. And I've told y'all before, I came into this world with somebody else's blood on me and I don't mind going out the same way. I would have fought. I mean, there would have been kicking and screaming. There would have been bloodshed, mine, theirs, anybody else's that could have came around. I'm just being honest with you all who I am. But I am striving and I'm learning to be more like this Daniel. So thank you, church, for helping me in that mode. But the king was so disturbed about this one man named Daniel that was making a difference for his faith that it kept the king up that night. He didn't eat. He didn't get his entertainment. He just stayed up. But very early the next morning, verse 19, the king got up and hurried out to the lion's den. When he got there, he called out in anguish, Daniel, servant of the living God, was your God, whom you serve so faithfully, able to rescue from the lions? Daniel answered, long live the king. My God sent his angels to shut the lions' mouths so that they would not hurt me, for I have been found innocent in his sight, and I have not wronged you, your majesty. I love art. And I love a picture that my dad had hanging in his study. And he's had it for, oh gosh, 30 years or more. And it's a picture of Daniel. And this is the picture that my dad has in his study. It shows a picture, a replica. I'm quite sure that nobody was there with their cell phone taking a snappy, you know, of Daniel, you know, or Daniel, you know, like, you know, taking a selfie of him in the lion's den with the lions. But there's three pictures that I want to show you that over the years, over the centuries, that artists have painted of this particular scenario. And I want to show you the significant difference in them. You notice that Daniel is standing in a reverent position with his hands behind his back, which, by the way, is a prayer position. You see, there's many prayer positions in which we can get in. And each one of them have their own symbolics to it. There's the kneeling. There is the laying flat, there is the lifted hands and head, But there's also the posture of the hands behind the back. This particular position represents that of total surrender. You know, today, whenever you're arrested and they put handcuffs on you, where do they put your hands? Now, some of y'all are answering because you've got experience with that. I've been in handcuffs. Just as a joke, though. And so they put them behind it. Whenever you put your hands behind your back to pray to God, you're showing God, I am under your control. I am under your authority. I am going to obey your orders. It is a place of total surrender. Notice the picture. How did this artist picture Daniel praying with his hands behind his back and his face lifted up, and the enemy, the lions, are to his back? Point one I want you to take. Whenever the enemy is coming, don't try to face the enemy until you have faced God first. And when Daniel was already in the custom, usually, as he always does, in prayer, when they threw him into the lion's den, he didn't have to learn how to pray with the enemy snipping at his heels. He already knew how to pray. He already knew how to worship God. He already knew the posture to get in to be able to show God, these lions look hungry and I look really delicious, but nevertheless, I'm yours. When Jesus was going to go to the cross, he went into the Garden of Gethsemane, and there he knelt down, he prayed, and I may I say, with his hands behind his back, because he said, Father, if it be thy will that this cup pass from me, so let it be, but nevertheless, thy will be done. Daniel's standing here in the same position. Lord, I look like I'm fixing to become supper for these lions, but nevertheless, your will be done. If I live, as Paul says, I gain. But if I die, I even gain more. So here I am. Lord, I'm yours. But here again, the most important thing is before you ever try to face your enemies, make sure you face God and you know how to pray. Then I want you to look at the second picture. The second picture then shows Daniel still with his hands behind his back, still showing total surrender to God. And he's looking down at the enemies. His lions. You cannot have, brothers and sisters, you cannot have that kind of courage to be able to face your enemies until you have first faced God. And he turned around and looked at those lions. Now, I love how the artist has painted the different expressions on the lion's face. You see that there's one king lion in there. He's just kind of studying him up. He might be, you know, just kind of setting the mood. He might be summing him up saying, yeah, that arm, that leg, that's mine. But whatever it may be, you also notice that there's another lion in the background with his mouth open and growling. You see that lioness there? You see, there's probably always going to be somebody's dog in the background barking at them to get them to do what they're trying to do that is not right. Because see, the lioness knew that they don't attack until the king attacked, the king lion here, the male lion. And so she's back there agging it on. Come on, do something. You know, come on, you call yourself the king of the jungle. Come on, do something, you know. And the king's standing there saying, not yet, not yet, not yet. So always notice that a lot of times the one that seems to be doing the loudest growling probably has somebody in the background poking and agging them on. You with me on this? But you also notice there's a couple of others that are kind of sad looking in their face. I don't want to be here. But I am. And this is just the way that it is. Do you notice the different expressions in the lion's face? I don't know exactly which one Daniel is looking at in this picture. But it shows that he's summarized, you know, he's kind of summing them up just like what I was just teaching you about. But here again, make sure that before you ever face your enemy, God is on, you are on God's side. Don't try to get God on your side. You make sure you're on God's side. And be willing to accept whatever God wants to do, because even with martyrs, it still brings glory to God. Now, we notice that he faced God, then he was able to face his enemy, and then we see this picture, and that is, this is a picture of King Darius looking down into the hole saying, Daniel, did you survive? And being able to hear the voice of Daniel saying, yes, I'm alive and well, and meet my friends. And you know why those animals didn't touch Daniel? It's because God is in control of even nature, even the animals. And God sent an angel, the scripture tells us, and I can only imagine, and I love how my daddy used to tell this story and everything, and he says, that angel probably walked up to some of those lions and said, hey, you see him? You touch him? And I'll knock every tooth you got out on your head. You see them? You touch him, and I will jerk every bit of that mane out of your head. You leave him alone. Now, let me assure you, if an angel came up to you and poked you in the side and told you, you better stop, you're going to stop. Because angels are not these little fluffy little things that fly around with wings and harps and sit on angel wings, you know, and play their harps on clouds and everything. That's not an angel, folks. Every time the Bible ever mentions that there was an angel there, there was great fear. And the angel had to calm them down if it was a situation where they needed to be calmed down. Read every story in the Bible you want to about the angels. They always had to say, fear not, peace be with you. But these angels showed up. And they were the Alpha. And they came in. Leave this man alone. And they didn't bother him. I even see in this picture where Daniel probably was able to go over there and say, nice kitty, kitty, kitty. Ooh, ain't you a big one? Where before he was like, he didn't go into the lion's den saying, oh, come here, kitty, kitty, let me hold you. Oh, you look so sweet and everything. Oh, I just want to pick you up and just hold you. He didn't go in a hole like that. But courage is what's taken over because of his faith. That even when God is in control, he can even make our enemies even our friends. Now, let me take something with you right here, okay? A lady that's had an abortion is not my enemy. A man who forced a lady to go have an abortion is not my enemy. The doctor and the nurses that perform the abortion procedure, they're not my enemy. I don't wrestle with flesh and blood, the scripture tells me. My enemy is the principalities of the things of the harm that they have done to the unborn. But as far as then how I would treat them, I'm not going to treat them as an enemy where I would go like some Christians have done and bomb their clinics and shoot them at a distance and things like that. Let me denounce that is not Christianity. That is not what the church is here for. And if you think that was just wonderful, me and you need to have a talk. But instead, we just need to be able to face our enemy. And I pray that as we've seen so many in the abortion industry come to faith in Christ. Do you know who Norma Jean, I wrote her name down and I forgot it, starts with an M. She was the original Roe in Roe versus Wade. I'd say they used a pseudonym there. Not McElveen, but something similar to that. You know that years later, she got saved, and she became a very outspoken person against the abortion industry. Sad thing is that she died 5 years ago, and she did not get to see this nation finally come back to reality. So I'm just telling you, I don't want to go lay down with the enemy, but I'm not going to stay in the hole not 1 second longer than what I have to. But I'm just going to let God be God. So let's continue the story. Then the king was overjoyed and ordered that Daniel be lifted from the den. Not a scratch was found on him, for he had trusted in his God. Then the king gave orders to arrest the man who had maliciously accused Daniel. He had them thrown into the lion's den along with their wives and children. The lions leaped on them and tore them apart before they even hit the floor of the den. Then the king Darius sent this message to the people of every race and nation and language throughout the world. Peace and prosperity to you. Now, I don't have time to try to theologically take apart about what King Darius did about taking those that were guilty of accusing wrongly Daniel and throwing them into the lion's den, along with their wives and their children. But let me just say this right here. Always know, listen to me, always know that so much of the decisions that you make 100% of the time will affect other people, especially those in whom you love the most, starting with your family. So whenever you make a decision and you feel like it ain't gonna affect nobody else, it will greatly affect everybody else, especially your family. So peace and prosperity to you was what he was saying. He says, I decree that everyone throughout my kingdom should tremble with fear before the God of Daniel, for he is the living God, and he will endure forever. His kingdom will never be destroyed, and his rule will never end. It took an incident like this to be able to open the eyes to this king to realize that God is God. And then he says, he rescues and saves his people. He performs miraculous signs and wonders in the heavens and on earth. He has rescued Daniel from the power of the lions. So Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Now, here's real quick, just something else I want you to understand. And then I got a final thought for you. And that is, Daniel did not come out of that den bragging about, yeah, I stared down those lions. You know, y'all need to look at me. Look at how brave I am. I went in there with some lion propellant, you know. Yes, sir. Whatever it may be. He didn't have to. Because Daniel knew that his job was to glorify God. And then he goes, so I want to come back to this final thought right here, because the title of the sermon is Get, Keep, and Have Faith. First off, who is your faith in? Is your faith just in yourself, or is it in God? Put it in God. And then, what is your faith in? When you say God, God's not a what, God is a who. So what is your faith in? What is going to be the Word of God? My faith is in my prayers that I pray to God. My faith is in those things of God, but ultimately it's in the who, and that is God. And then, when is your faith exercised? You see, God sometimes will allow us to be in a lion's den to get us to exercise our faith because we've gotten fat and lazy and sassy, and we just don't exercise our faith, and what you don't exercise will begin to die and decay. So God will allow sometimes the lion dens to come to us so that we will exercise our faith. So when is your faith exercised? First off, exercise it daily so that you'll be ready for the marathon whenever the lion then come, okay? And then, where is your faith known? Is it only known in your private little prayer closet that nobody else can see? Or is your faith known even in the public? Now, let me assure you this right here. You can wear all the Christian garbs. You can even get Christian tattoos. You can have all the Christian bumper stickers you want and all the jewelry. But if your words and actions do not back up what you're advertising, stop wearing that kind of stuff. Now, but is your faith even known in the public? And saying this is something you need to teach your children and your grandchildren to make sure they know that they do not need to hide their faith even in school. If teachers can advertise that they are one of the alphabet people, then children ought to be able to advertise that they are Christians and that they go to church. Now, where is your faith known? Let me tell you a little something. Your faith has even known that whenever you're sitting in a restaurant by yourself and you take a moment before you start eating and you bow your head and you close your eyes, and if it's not but just for a second to say, thank you, Lord, for this food, amen. There might be somebody else in that restaurant that just saw that, and they're going to identify you as being a person of faith. They will. So sometimes, you know, it's even whenever we practice random acts of kindness. No, let your faith be known. And then, how is your faith today? Right now, some of you, some of us, we're trying to face the enemy without first facing God. Some of you, you're in a place where maybe you've just come through a victory and you want everybody to look at you and say, look at what I did, look at how good I am. You know, y'all all need to take pictures and post me on Facebook, and I need to write a book about this experience. And God has very little to do with it, because your faith is only in you, not in God. And another thing is that how is your faith today? And that is that, like I said a while ago, what you don't exercise will just melt away. So therefore, is your faith being exercised today? Wherever it is, wherever you are in this journey, either get the faith or keep growing in your faith. And if you need faith in God today to save your soul, we're here to introduce you to Jesus. And if you say, I'm saved, then we're also here to help you to exercise your faith. And just like Daniel had his friends, we want to be your friend. And we'll be glad to pray with you, help you in any way we possibly can. As Michael comes and leads us in this song of invitation, have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Even whenever we are in the lion's den. Let's stand together as we sing hymn number 294. You come, the altar's open, and also I'll be glad to meet with you after church. Truly have the faith of Daniel. Maybe you need to quit trying to pray for the patience of Job and start praying for the faith of Daniel. Thank you so much for being here today. Remember the things in which we have talked about this day, and if you need help in any of these areas, know we're here as a church, and don't hesitate in reaching out. We want to help you to be able to grow in your faith. Also, I've been asked to announce, first off, thank you, ladies, for the wonderful women's fellowship y'all had yesterday. I saw the pictures, and I have heard the reports, and I know y'all had a wonderful time. And they have some of the cups with flowers left over, and they're in the Welcome Center, so if any of you all would like to get one, please do so. All righty, let's go out of here with a hand lifted up. Our benediction says, the Lord keeps you from all harm and watches over your life. The Lord keeps watch over you as you come and go, both now and forever. And all of God's people said, amen.